Right. Good morning, Harvest. Morning. My name is Jonathan Clemens. I'll be leading us through announcements for today. So first, a big welcome to all of our visitors. If you're new and visitor here and you haven't checked in with us, we invite you to text us today to receive a special introduction to Harvest. Text WELCOME at 559-245-6200. And can everyone please make sure to fill out our friendship registers? They are located on the inside of your aisles. We just want to learn a little bit about you and also let us know how we can pray for you. If you would like for your prayer to be private, just mark private, and then our elders will make sure to pray for you. Then pass it on to your neighbor in the aisle. Happy Mother's Day to all those mothers out there. Make sure that you grab a family picture after church if you haven't gotten one already. And for all those ladies who are over 18 years and over, then there will be a special gift for you as well, regardless of your mothering status. Change for Babies. We're also kicking off Change for Babies. From now until Father's Day, we'll be raising money for the Pregnancy Care Center. They help women who often make the difficult decision to choose life for the unborn child. You could pick up a baby bottle outside of the service today and fill it up with either change, cash, or a check. Just make the check out to the Pregnancy Care Center. And next is a women's retreat. It's time to register for the Harvest Fresno Women's Retreat. It will be from August 4th through the 6th up at Calvin Crest. We will be blessed to have Elise Fitzpatrick speaking. The cost for all members will be and regular attenders will be $200 per person. This includes 2 nights and 5 meals. For anyone who doesn't attend Harvest, the cost will be $240. We will send a special discount code to our women via the weekly email to bring the price down to $200. And there will also be a way to donate to the scholarship fund. And lastly, get added to the email list. As you may know, there's a lot of different information that goes out each week through emails. Make sure that you, if you're not getting emails, make sure that you email us at church@harvestfresno.org and you'll be added to the list. But if you have any questions at all about the announcements, make sure to also email at church@harvestfresno.org. And let's stand for worship.
Good morning and happy Mother's Day. Let's stand together. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
He chosen seed,
chosen seed of Israel's race, he ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown. Join the everlasting song. Jesus' name.
Amen. Miss Paula is going to share from Psalm chapter 8.
Good morning. Good morning, church. How's everybody doing this morning? So this is Psalms 8, as Brian said. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to steal the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen and all the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, you're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will, and I choose to pray. When
Shadow of forgiveness and redemption. We We say thank you. And it's in your holy and precious name that we pray. Amen. If you're just coming in, we want to welcome you and say happy Mother's Day. You may be seated. We have a little video.
Well, it's finally happened. You've moved out. You're on your own. Congratulations. But everyone still needs a little help sometimes.
Mom, have you seen my wallet?
It's in your back pocket.
Nah, I checked there.
Your other back pocket, dear.
Ah. Thanks, Mom.
Introducing the Mom Personal Assistant, the only smart speaker device with all the wisdom, caring, and sage advice of a mother.
Mom, please call Brad.
Honey, I'm just not sure he's right for you.
Just call him.
Okay, calling Ryan.
No, Mom, I said call Brad.
Trust me.
The Mom PA always has your best interests in mind.
Wish me luck, Mom. Big interview today.
Did you eat breakfast?
Is
that what you're wearing?
Wait, what?
Did you even shower?
She's there to provide a helping hand whenever you need it.
Mom, set a timer for 40 minutes. Mom?
The Mom Personal Assistant won't function until you say the magic word.
Oh, right. Mom, please set a timer for 40 minutes.
Sure thing, hun, but it's only 30 minutes for that dish.
The Mom PA is always correct and basically knows everything.
Mom, what setting should I use for this laundry?
Mom, do you think I should color my hair?
Hey, Mom, can you please order mac and cheese?
You still have two boxes.
What? No, we're out.
Did you look?
Yeah, I just looked. It's gone.
Do you want me to look?
No, it's okay. I'll go look again.
Try looking with your eyes this time.
Based on God's perfect design, the Mom Personal Assistant is thoughtful, kind, encouraging, and supportive.
You are beautiful. It's okay. You're gonna get through this. I am so proud of you. You can change the world. But right now, hon, you really need to change your socks because they smell like a dumpster.
Ugh, Mom.
The Mom Personal Assistant. Always help.
Mother's Day is here where we honor and celebrate mothers. And I also know that it could be a time of mixed emotions. Some have had incredible experiences with their mothers and some not so great. I understand that. There are some who have tried to be mothers and for a variety of reasons have not been able to have children. Others maybe had a child when they weren't ready and gave it up for adoption. So again, I'm not unmindful of the fact that Mother's Day is a day with perhaps mixed feelings and emotions. However, I think we could all agree that being a mother is hard. It's not easy being a mother. So I'd like to read a few quotes about motherhood that kind of reflect the trials and the difficulties of being a mother. Number one, silence is golden unless you have kids. Then silence is just suspicious. If you're not yelling most of the time at your kids, you're not spending enough time with them. And if motherhood were easy, fathers would do it. Ooh. Nothing is really lost until mom can't find it. Being a mom means kids banging on the bathroom door like SWAT, asking for a drink while you're in the shower and dad is in the kitchen. The quickest way for a mother to get her child's attention is to sit down and look comfortable. When I raise my voice, my kids call it yelling, but I call it motivational speaking with selective hearing. I don't want to sleep like a baby. I want to sleep like my husband. And when my kids become wild and unruly, I use a nice, safe playpen, and when they're finished, I climb out. Raising kids is like a walk in the park, Jurassic Park. No doubt, motherhood is hard. And you know what? Life is hard. Life is hard. We live in a fallen world. Life is hard for everyone at different periods and different seasons in a person's life. There are times when it just actually, our pain and suffering just seems overwhelming. Our anguish, it's just unbearable. And this can, in certain circumstances, go on for an extended period of time. When this happens, it could be a very lonely time. It could be a time when you feel abandoned, where you feel forgotten, forsaken. You feel unloved. If God knew what you're going through, why wouldn't he intervene? Why wouldn't he do something? You feel far from God, distant from God. As if he doesn't care what's happening. Why don't you do something, God? Take this pain away. Take this anguish away. Do something. Well, the portion of scripture that we're dealing with, it's a time when Israel felt abandoned, forgotten, and forsaken by God. And God responds to them with words of encouragement. So, the portion of scripture we're going to look at today is from Isaiah chapter 49, verses 14 to 16. And it says, "But Zion said, 'The Lord has forsaken me, my Lord has forgotten me.' The Lord responds, 'Can a woman forget her nursing child, that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands, and your walls are continually before me.'" From this passage, we're going to look at three encouragements when you feel forsaken. Three encouragements when you feel forsaken. Now, this passage is the second of what's called the servant song. And this really starts in chapter 42 of Isaiah, where a servant of the Lord is described who is suffering, and as a result of his suffering, there is salvation. He is a deliverer. He is a rescuer. He's going to bring salvation to the world. And this passage was read when Israel was in captivity by the Babylonians for years and years and years and years. So they're reading this passage about all these promises, and they still feel like they're in distress. And they question God. Where are you? So this passage provides the encouragements that we often need when we are feeling distressed, forsaken, and even forgotten by the Lord. So three encouragements when you feel forsaken. The first is the Lord knows your distress. The Lord knows your distress. It says, "But Zion said, 'The Lord has forsaken me, my Lord has forgotten me.'" Now, Zion is another name for Israel. And to understand this properly, we have to look at the context. What was said right before that? Well, there is a bunch of promises in Isaiah chapter 49, verses 8 to 13, those verses immediately preceding 14 and 16, what we talked about. God promises a time of God's favor and a day of salvation. He will enable his servant to make a covenant with a people, and the covenant promises with Israel. He will say to the prisoners, "Come out. Those that are in darkness, appear. You shall be fed. You're not going to hunger or thirst. The scorching sun and wind will not strike you." He will lead them to springs of water and guide them. He will reduce the mountains, these big obstacles, and turn them into roads. So, the Jewish people are in captivity, reading about these promises of deliverance, reading that the prisoners can be set free, and here they are in prison. They're enslaved, and they've been there for 70 years. They're saying, they're hearing these promises. And then as a result of these promises, they're told to sing out to the Lord with praise. "Sing with joy, O heavens, and exalt the earth. Break forth, O mountains." So, they're reading this and they're saying, yeah. That sounds great. Who is that for? You said Zion, but we're not experiencing it. We're not feeling the love. We're enslaved. And so, They had no assurance. By their circumstances, that God was there, that God remembered them, that God loves them. In fact, the Babylonians told them, their captors told them to sing, to entertain them with music. And their response in Psalm 137, verses 3 and 4 is, "For our captors require us of us songs, and our tormentors mirth and saying, sing one of the songs, Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land?" They couldn't even sing. There was no joy. There was no ability for mirth. This is a situation where you look at the landscape, however colorful it may be, and all you see is gray. It's desolate. There's just pain and anguish. Now, mothers, there are times when you feel also forsaken and forgotten, abandoned and unloved. Motherhood is hard. Many suffer from postpartum depression, where you have all these obligations, all these demands, and you just feel numb. And then you feel guilty. There's sleep deprivation, waking up every couple of hours to feed your child, and then the day is on. Everything else needs to be done. Cooking, cleaning, washing, which relates to the monotony of early motherhood. Feeding, changing diapers, doing laundry, feeding, cleaning, and again, all the other household chores. Over and over and over again, day in and day out. And the guilt. You do anything for yourself, being a mother, you feel guilty. And you're constantly being judged. If you're a working mother, you're being judged by stay-at-home moms. If you're a stay-at-home mom, you're being judged by working mothers. There's just constant judgment about what you do, whatever you do. And the expectations of others. They don't stop because you're a mother. They increase. The family still wants meals on the table, still have to clean the house. You have to do everyone else's laundry. There's still all the demands. Helping kids with homework and being a seductress to your husband. Trying to do it all. And then you just feel lonely. Feel overwhelmed. Can't do this. I don't even have time to spend with the Lord. And you feel guilty about that. And this just scratches the surface. It's easy for a mother to feel forsaken and forgotten by the Lord. But this happens also to everyone. Again, suffering and trials and pain are not unique to just mothers. There's a special pain and anguish that mothers experience, but everyone does. As I said, we live in a fallen world. We have to deal with all sorts of issues, right? So, there's certain circumstances that create this sense of being forsaken and forgotten. And that is typically long periods of distress. When there's a long period of distress, when it just looks like it's not going away, we feel like we're forgotten and forsaken by the Lord. David experienced all of these different emotions. And you could always go to the Psalms. When you're feeling this way, that's one of the best places to look at. Look at Psalm 69, verses 1 to 3. This is David crying out, "Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I'm sink deep in mire. There is no foothold. I've come into deep waters. The floods sweep over me. I am weary of my crying out. My throat is parched. My eyes grow dim with waiting on my Lord." It could be an illness. It could be a long period of financial distress. It could be a marital problem. It could be a wayward child that you just see going down a path of destruction, and you pray and you pray and you pray. You hope to end, something will happen, and nothing happens. Another condition that brings up this feeling of being forsaken and forgotten is when we're stuck in sin, particularly egregious sin. Again, look at the case with David. When he sinned with Bathsheba and ordered the execution of her husband, Uriah, in Psalm 32, David said, "For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as in the heat of the summer." So there's times when we're in sin, and we just feel the weight and the oppression of it in our lives. And this could happen with not just an egregious single sin, but habitual sin. Where like a dog returns to vomit in the Bible, you just keep going to that sin that you thought you got rid of it, and you just keep going back to that one sin over and over and over again. You're sick of it. You don't understand. You've cried out to the Lord, "Take this away from me," and nothing happens. You keep going back to that particular sin over and over again. You feel like, "I must have exhausted God's grace. Maybe I've committed the unpardonable sin. Maybe I'm not a Christian." You think about all of these different things, and you just feel alone and forgotten, abandoned. And of course, one last thing that produces that feeling of being forsaken is just simply unanswered prayer. It's something that we pray about. God promises to answer the prayers of his children, and yet we pray and 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 we pray, and we don't see anything happening. And again, these are situations that often we're in hardship and we're in anguish and we're suffering, and we pray for that to be taken away from us, for there to be relief, and we don't experience it. We don't feel it, and we grow impatient. At the root of feeling forsaken is ultimately feeling unloved, right? If God really loved me, he would do something about this suffering. He would do something about this pain. And then we look at other people, and it just seems like God's blessing is just poured upon them, and everything they do seems right, and then we're just stuck in anguish and in pain. What is going on? There's favor for them, and then I'm being punished. I'm being forsaken. I'm abandoned. What this does is it causes us to find love and acceptance elsewhere. When we're not feeling the love of God, then we want to feel love. So we find it in improper relationships. You find it in the workplace, where you get the rewards and you get the kudos for working hard, and then you spend long hours and overtime because that's where you're receiving your love. Ultimately, it's not believing God loves us. Charles Spurgeon put it this way: "Unbelief, which often makes us talk about God forgetting us, when he does nothing of the kind, we know not which most wonder at, the faithfulness of God for the unbelief of his people. He keeps his promise 1,000 times, and yet the next trial makes us doubt him. He never fails. He is never a dry well. He is never a setting sun, a passing meteor, a melting vapor, and yet we are continually vexed with anxieties, molested with suspicions, and disturbed with fears, as if God were the mirage in a desert." Did the Lord know what Israel was going through? Of course he did. He is the one that sent Babylon to invade Jerusalem and conquer them and make them captives. It was even prophecy. He ordained it. He made it happen. God had not forgotten or forsaken Israel or circumstances in the slightest bit. He created them. He also knows exactly what you are going through. In Ephesians 1:11, it says that all things work after the counsel of God's will. All things. And in Matthew chapter 10, verse 21, it says, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father? But even the hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear not. Are you not more valuable than sparrows? No matter how you feel, the Lord knows your distress. He knows your pain. He knows your anguish. He knows the suffering that you are experiences, that you experience. The Bible makes it clear. For we don't have a high priest who is not sympathetic with our weaknesses, but who in every respect was tempted as we were, but yet without sin. So we could have confidence and draw near to the throne of grace to find mercy and help whenever we have need. God became a man. And he was tempted and suffered and endured and was tempted every way which we were. And we could go to him always because he knows what we're going through. And secondly, the Lord's comfort is guaranteed. So not only does he know what you're going through, however you feel, like he's forgotten you, that's just not true, he also promises for you to be comforted. He says in verse 15, can a woman forget her nursing child that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you. Notice what the Lord doesn't say. Here's Zion, right? They're crying out, you've forgotten us, Lord God. And the Lord doesn't say, are you kidding me? After all I've done, you really think I've forgotten you? You still doubt me? Come on. Pull yourself up by the bootstraps. Get tough. Persevere. You're going to get through this. That's not what he says. He uses the metaphor of a woman and a nursing child. He could have used a number of different relationships to express his love and his affection for Israel and for his children, you. Right? You think of a relationship where there's friendships and marriages and all sorts of relationships. But there's something particularly unique about a mother's relationship to a nursing infant. How is this relationship unique, and how does it represent God's love and him not forgetting you? Well, first of all, the relationship is unconditional. Again, you look at the most intimate relationship between a husband and wife, you ultimately choose your spouse. You choose to be with your spouse or not to be with your spouse. Also, there's reciprocity. At the end of the day, there's a husband and a wife, and they have to do something, right? They have to have some level of communication, some level of doing what a husband is supposed to do and what a wife is supposed to do. One just can't sit there and never speak ever, and you have a relationship of a husband and wife. That's just not how it goes. There's give and take. And sometimes there's more give, and sometimes there's more take, but ultimately it's a give and take relationship. That's not the case with a mother and a nursing child. There's no conditions. There's no give and take. There's only take, take, take by the child. It doesn't matter what the child looks like, whether he could communicate. The mother is completely devoted to that nursing baby no matter what. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The mother gives herself entirely over to that infant, is completely devoted to that infant. The nursing mother has determined unilaterally to care and set her affection and love upon that child. Secondly, the relationship is biological or physiological. Now, God created life, right? He designed it. He's the software engineer behind life. He wrote the operating system for all of life, including mothers and nursing babies. So what happens? Mothers, can you forget, when you're nursing, can you forget your baby? Try. What happens? Your breasts become what? Engorged. And what happens? They hurt. They ache. If you are neglecting your child, your own breasts hurt. There's a hormone called prolactin, and it takes over to stimulate the glands that produce the milk. And there's oxytocin, which is another hormone that sends the chemical signal to the cells to release the milk. If a mother does not feed her child, something happens. It doesn't work. A mother is hardwired to feed her child. And God, by his nature, is hardwired to love his child, to love you and never forsake you. It is part of his nature. He can't do anything other than that. Also, mothers, what happens when your babies cry? Try to forget them. Try to ignore the cry. What happens? You have a letdown. And guys, that's not when someone doesn't live up to their part of the deal. The mother's milk secretes when the baby cries. How can a mother forget her child? She's biologically hardwired to remember her child. Even if she tries to forget her child, she can't. And that's how it is with God and you. It is part of his nature. Just as a mother can't possibly forget her child, neither can God forget you. He would cease to be who he is. He would go against every aspect of his nature, because his love and his nature is hardwired to love you and remember you. And there's also an emotional connection. Along with the milk comes tremendous feelings and emotions. Sometimes it's the milk that brings the emotions, and sometimes the feelings and the thoughts actually produce the milk. So not only can the mother not forget the child because of physiological reasons, there's emotional reasons. And in fact, in recent studies, they did MRI scans and they did tests with nursing mothers. The response time of a nursing mother to her child is less than 5 seconds, which is faster than a non-nursing mother. Also, they did MRI studies in the brain to see what happens, things are triggered in the brain, and the ones that are relating to emotions are just lit up in a nursing mother. So there's this emotional connection. So not only is there the relationship unconditional, not dependent on you, what you do, but on God, not only is it physiological, but it's emotional. There's an emotional connection. There's a relationship between a mother and a child that is powerful. It is very powerful. In prison, at least in a level 4 maximum security prison, If you were to go to the visiting room, you'd only see really two types of visitors. You would see a prisoner with perhaps a girlfriend or a wife, but then those can be fleeting. They're just looking for someone to support them. The only other real visitor that you see is what? A mother. A prisoner may have burned through every single relationship that he has ever had, except he is unable to burn the bond with his mother. The relationship is powerful. As powerful as it is, look at the second part of verse 15. Can a woman forget a nursing child that he should have no compassion on the son of his womb? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you. As close is the bond between a mother and a child, that of God and you is far greater, far more powerful. What he's saying is God's love and affection may seem unconditional, but, and it may seem powerful, but it's not indestructible. Mothers are finite. Children are finite. Mothers are sinners. Children are sinners. So there could be a fraction in the relationship that pretty much ends that relationship. Or just over a period of time, a mother may eventually get senile and not even recognize her own child. That could happen. But that will never happen with God and you. He will always remember you. It's impossible. His relationship with you is indestructible. It is more powerful. It is unbreakable. There's nothing that you could do that could sever that relationship. However you may feel abandoned, however you may feel forsaken, however you may feel forgotten, whatever you're going through, whatever pain and anguish you may be going through, however deep the sin you may be involved with, however far away you feel from God, it is impossible for him to forget and to forsake you. The scriptures say in Psalm 56:8, you have kept count of my tossings, put my tears in a bottle. Are they not in your book? What does that mean? That God knows all of your sorrow. He knows all of your pain. He knows all of your struggles. He knows every single tear that you have shed. Not even a loving mother knows that. God's love and remembrance is powerful and indestructible. We're looking at encouragements when you feel forsaken. First, the Lord knows your distress. Secondly, your comfort is guaranteed. And thirdly, your comfort is eternal. Look at verse 16. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. He begins with behold, which means listen up. I got something important to tell you. One commentator called it a divine highlighter. What does he say? What does he say? What does he want you to really pay attention to? That he has engraved you on the palms of his hands. How can he possibly forget you? Now, God is spirit, right? He doesn't have literal hands. This is an anthropomorphism, which means that he uses human terms so that we would better understand him. Okay? So just, he talks about having nostrils and things like that. He doesn't. It's just ways that we can better understand and comprehend who God is. So, why would someone tattoo a name on him or herself? The practice existed in the ancient days as well. It's when you want to show your commitment to that person, right? With the proliferation of tattoos, you see this everywhere now. Here's a clip of one person describing.
Do you have a tattoo?
Yes, I have a few.
Really?
Yes.
Where are
Aren't you just rethinking me completely
yes.
right now?
You're not who I thought you were, Julia.
Yes.
What are they of and where are they? Let's
well,
see them.
Well, some things I can tell you the answer to and some things I'll tell you later.
Okay, tell me what you can now.
I have all my children's names and my husband's initials.
Oh, you didn't want to commit to his name?
Well, you know, actually, it was, we were brave or idiotic because it was before we got married.
Oh, that you put your children's names on? If we have kids, I'm gonna put...
It's all coming back to me now. How really happy and stupid I feel when I sit here, because you're so sharp.
Now, tell me about, so you got your husband's initials before you got married, and he got yours? Where are they?
This happened last time,
I know. I like it.
Okay. So you see, people have affection for their children. They may do that. And even those children often can put the dad or mother, right? How popular is this tattoo of a mother, right? Mom. Expressing that devotion to one another. But here's the thing. In ancient times, a slave would bear the mark or tattoo of his master. A master would never tattoo the name of a slave on him. It would show that master's devoted to the slave. No, it's the other way around. So that would never happen. But in this case, God is putting your name on his palms. That is unheard of. When you understand the practice of the relationship, there are a couple of other unique things about what is being said here. He has engraved you on his palms. This is not a tattoo. This is not a rub-off decal. This isn't even inscribing you with a magic marker or a Sharpie. Any of those, this is something that is engraved. It means to cut out, inscribe. A hammer and chisel. It cannot be erased. It cannot be washed out. It cannot wear out. It can never be removed. It means that you are permanently and eternally engraved upon his palm. What this means is that relationship is forever. There's no chance of severing your relationship with the Lord. This goes to the doctrine of once saved, always saved. In John chapter 10, verse 28 to 29, says Jesus put it this way, I give them eternal life and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of their hand. My Father who's given them to me is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. God always has a grip on you. You are eternally secure. And also, by engraving you on his palms, what does it mean? It means that you're always present before him. It's impossible for him to forget. When you think about it, he didn't put your name on his shoulder. He didn't put his name, your name, that you're you on his back. He put it on his palms. How often do you see you can't do anything, literally, without seeing your palms. They're always in front of you. And so you are always in front of the Lord. He can't help but see you. And notice that God inscribes you. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. He doesn't say I inscribed or I engraved your name on my palms. He said, I inscribed you on my palms. Spurgeon once again said, God has engraved your personhood, your image, your circumstances, your sins, your temptations, your weaknesses, your wants, your works. He has engraved you, everything about you, everything that concerns you is engraved on his palm. All of you. How could you ever say that God has forsaken you? You are engraved on his palm. Every aspect about you, all of who you are, the good, the bad, the ugly, everything in between, is ever before him. I mentioned before, this was not a magic marker. This was not a pen. The idea is that he engraved you. This is bloody. This is taking a hammer and chisel to his own hand. So this answers the question, how did he engrave you on his palms? The answer is when the nails were driven through our Savior's hands. And he was crucified. When Thomas was told that Jesus rose from the dead, he was filled with doubt. He was still in distress and fear. He said, unless I see the hands and the marks of the nails, and place my finger in the mark of the nail, and place my hand in it, I won't believe. In response to this, what does the Lord Jesus do? See my hands. See my hands. The nail that was hammered into the palm of Christ is how you know you have been engraved on the palms of the Lord. How can he forget you? How can he forsake you? You are ever before him. He is marked by you. Matthew records over 2,000 years ago, chapter 27. At the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Do you see? The Lord was forsaken so that you will never be. The Lord was abandoned. The Lord God turned his back on Jesus so that he will never turn his back on you, that you are always before him. That your love that is always poured out to you because our Lord was forsaken for you. How can he forget you? How can he love you more than that? What does he have to do? God's very own precious Son was sacrificed, was forgotten and forsaken, so that you will never be. God knows what you're going through, and God loves you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your words. We thank you for your faithfulness. Even when we're unfaithful, you are faithful. We are so grateful that you will never leave us nor forsake us, that the relationship is unconditional. No matter what we do, you are always pouring your love, your affection, your comfort upon us. I pray, Lord, that we would have ears to hear and eyes to see you in the midst of our distress, in the midst of our sorrow. When we're feeling lonely and downcast and feeling abandoned and forsaken, let us remember the nails that were put through Jesus' palms, so that will be a remembrance for us of your love. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.
Can we stand together? Sing with Kayla, standing on this mountaintop.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing that for every step you're powering us. Scars and struggles on
worshiping with all of you today, and if there's someone who has not put their faith and trust in Jesus, we'd love to show you through the gospel how you could have that eternal love by God, where you will never be alone, you will never be forgotten or forsaken, and that you are permanently etched in the palm of his hand. So please see us afterwards. And again, if you have not taken your picture, then please, after service, go. There's a booth set up so you could get your family pictures. The Lord said, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of the glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever. And all of God's people said, amen. Thank you. You're loved.